The FIGHT study was a study looking at a novel anti-FGFR2 antibody called Bemarituzumab. And that antibody had been studied in a preceding study in the phase one and expansion cohort of monotherapy in late lines. And this antibody binds to a receptor FGFR2, fibroblast growth factor receptor 2. And in terms of background of those receptors, we're becoming more familiar with them because there have been other tumor types that have had breakthroughs in therapies as well. And so there's four known receptors, and in different tumor types, different receptors seem to be activated. Recently, we've seen bladder cancer with FGFR mutations, and in cholangiocarcinoma, we've seen FGFR2 fusions, translocations. And now in this disease, we're seeing FGFR2 amplification. And so some things about the amplification, the incidence or the rate of that is approximately 5% of gastroesophageal adenocarcinoma. It tends to have a poor prognosis based on retrospective analyses looking at that question. And so in addition to that, there are a subset of patients that will have overexpression of FGFR2 protein, but in the absence of gene amplification, similar to many other proteins that we talk about, HER2, MET, EGFR. And so the question there now with this novel antibody was, does this inhibiting this pathway with bemarituzumab lead to benefit in the amplified tumors and or those tumors that are not amplified but overexpressed? We do know that the tumors that are amplified generally do have overexpression and as a consequence, very similar to HER2 gene amplification. So in the preceding study, there were, after the safety and dose was established, a number of expansion cohorts were conducted. And some they were broken down by expression of FGFR2B, and the 2B being the splice variant of FGFR2 that seems to be overexpressed in tumor cells. And in the low cohorts or medium cohorts in terms of expression, there weren't really any responses identified, and as opposed to in the high expressors, of which all were determined to be amplified, gene amplified by FISH, there was about an 18% response rate to monotherapy in late line. And so based on those results, that led to moving the drug earlier into development into the first line setting. And originally was planned as a phase three study. The FIGHT study was originally a phase three study, global study, randomized placebo control with FOLFOX chemotherapy backbone. And through the duration of the study, it was anticipated that we would see approximately a 10%, maybe 15% incidence of FGFR2 overexpression, of which a subset of those would be gene amplified and the remainder would be overexpressed but not amplified. And the selection criteria eligibility to be eligible for the study amongst a number of typical criteria, there was also the expression of FGFR2B by immunohistochemistry and or by circulating tumor DNA, ctDNA analysis at baseline. And so either one could be positive and you would be eligible. The other unique feature of this study was that we allowed for one cycle of chemotherapy while patients were screening. This is a major issue, I think, in these biomarker selecting studies that require patients, newly diagnosed patients that have symptoms, to screen for a period of time with central analysis of biomarker tests and all the while not allowed to get therapy. And so that affects accrual negatively, and patients who can't wait because their symptoms won't allow them to. They can't swallow, for example, from G-junction cancer or esophageal cancer. And so this was sort of a novel approach that would allow for up to one cycle while screening of palliative therapy that we know can start getting on top of those symptoms while screening to see if one was eligible. And if eligible, then you would be randomized after that point. And so just under half of patients did receive one cycle of FOLFOX chemotherapy while awaiting therapy. So through the duration of the study, after about just over 150 patients were enrolled, we were seeing a screen positive rate higher than expected. It was closer to 30%. And at that point, it was a little unclear why it was so high compared to what we had been seeing in the prior cohorts that this assay was assessed. And so it was that, and coupled with some other factors, the decision was made to downsize to a phase two study and take a look at outcomes and to be sure we're on the right track and to have the right sort of cut points for positivity of the assay. So a few things about that assay are that the majority of patients that got on the study were IHC positive, but ctDNA negative. Many of the most patients had the testing done in parallel, and we have both tested, as opposed to 15 to 18% were ctDNA positive amongst the patients accrued. 95% approximately of the patients were IHC positive. A few patients were ctDNA positive and IHC negative and vice versa. And so based on that cutoff, which by IHC to be positive was to have an intensity score of 2+ or higher and an extensity score, meaning the percent of cell staining of 1% or higher. So, you know, the question was, is that too low? And are we letting some patients in that may not be driving benefit? So hence downsizing to take a look at what was going on before proceeding. And so then we see these analysis of the first look at the data where the progression-free survival and the intention to treat analysis of randomized patients was improved in the bemarituzumab arm, as was the first look at survival. And then interestingly, again, not unlike many other targeted therapies with biomarkers that have threshold cutoffs, that as we increase the threshold of positivity, in this case, keeping the intensity minimum of 2+, but increasing the minimum of extensity to 5% of cells and even to 10% of cells, we started to see improvement in both PFS and OS in terms of absolute numbers, but also in terms of hazard ratio improving and getting better. So with that understanding, we also saw that overall the response rate in all comers was about 15% higher in the bemarituzumab plus chemotherapy arm. And so all of these things were promising. In terms of the tolerability of the therapy, as a monotherapy, we didn't see a lot of major toxicities. There were a few corneal keratitis toxicities reported in the monotherapy late line study that were reversible. In this study, in the randomized phase two study, in the first line setting with chemotherapy, we did acknowledge and have to note that patients were on therapy a lot longer than in the late line setting. And so potentially cumulative toxicity could be a problem. And so we did see that there was a higher rate of stomatitis and also corneal toxicities in the bemarituzumab arm. And approximately 30% of patients discontinued the bemarituzumab as opposed to less than 5% of the placebo group and attributed to the corneal keratitis. So there's more data being generated and looked into about the details of the keratitis and the duration in terms of after stopping the therapy and how long it takes to resolve. What has been reported so far is the time frame in terms of resolving to completely resolved. And so the ophthalmology exams were every 8 weeks thereafter. So the time points are a little bit extended. And so in follow-up analyses, we'll be looking and delving into that a little bit deeper. But no doubt there is a known corneal toxicity that comes with treatment with this agent. And so that has to be balanced with the outcomes that we saw. So based on overall the data in aggregate, this is grounds, I think, for proceeding to a larger study now, which is already planned. And I'm looking at this further and potentially in a higher cutoff, as I was discussing earlier, in terms of what is going to be considered an FGFR2 positive tumor. But overall, the results are very promising.